Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu an la Ashhadu anna Muhammadar Rasulullah. Ashhadu anna Muhammadar Rasulullah. Hayya ala Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen.
فضل سے آج سے قادیان میں وہاں کا جلسہ سالانہ شروع ہے.
With the grace of the Almighty Allah, the Jalsa Salana is beginning in Qadian from today.
پارٹیشن کے بعد سے بعض لوگوں کے خیال میں بھارت کا جلسہ سالانہ.
Some people assume that since the partition in the subcontinent, this Jalsa is to be considered as the Jalsa Salana of India. However, Qadian has a special status as a result of being the abode of the promised Messiah alayhi salam. Also, because the message of the promised Messiah alayhi salam set forth from this town and reached to the corners of the world. Thus, this place also has a special value. Where on the one hand, this makes Qadian the center for the rejuvenation of Islam. There, it also makes the Jalsa Salanas, which are held in Qadian, into international Jalsa Salanas. With the grace of the Almighty Allah, today 32 or 33 countries are being represented in Qadian. So thus Qadian also holds a significance. The Jalsa Salanas, the annual conventions which are held in Qadian, are also of importance. The Ahmadis who reside in Qadian are also of significance. The Ahmadi participants who come to attend the Jalsa from all parts of the world are also of significance. This importance, however, will then truly become manifest and will become more purposeful when all the Ahmadis who live in this abode come to discharge the right of this importance. It is when the days and nights that are to be spent at the Jalsa are spent for the purpose of striving to obtain this objective and purpose. This is the objective which the true servant of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Imam of the time informed us was the objective of the Jalsa. He informed this to those people who came into a covenant of allegiance with him. Normally, the atmosphere and environment of any Jalsa held in the world has a spiritual effect on the attendees. And this is a sentiment that is oft mentioned by those who attend the Jalsas. However, the spiritual atmosphere of Jalsa Salana in Qadian has a different flavor and ambience altogether. Anyone who has attended the Jalsa Salana in Qadian would know this. Every sincere person should come to feel the special flavor and ambience. This is because in the atmosphere, in the streets and in the alleyways of this town, the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's true servant, the promised Messiah and Imam Mahdi, the fragrance of his sweet remembrance and memories, takes a person into a different spiritual world altogether. Thus, the advice and counsel that was received in this abode has a special flavor and a special effect. This should have a special impact on every sincere person. This is why I would like to draw the attention today of all the participants of the Jalsa Salana there, that where on the one hand, by participating in the Jalsa Salana, you will benefit from the scholarly and educational speeches that will be given. There on the other hand, you should also keep those objectives before you. Constantly remind yourselves of these purposes. These are the objectives that the Promised Messiah alayhi salam outlined were the objectives of the establishment of the Jalsa Salana. I believe that my representative in the inaugural session of the Jalsa Salana would have presented the objectives of the Jalsa Salana in the words of the Promised Messiah on whom be peace. I said that I think, because I am not aware of what was said in the inaugural speech. Because normally, the subject of the inaugural speech of the Jalsa Salana is in the context and in view of the objectives of the Jalsa Salana itself. But in any case, each and every participant of the Jalsa Salana should spend their days in the Jalsa Salana, keeping in mind the expectations that the Promised Messiah alayhi salam, on whom be peace, had. As I stated, numerous countries have been represented at this Jalsa Salana. One objective that the Promised Messiah on whom be peace outlined was that the members of the Jamaat should come to become more acquainted with one another during the days of the Jalsa. Relationships of love, brotherhood and affection should be formed. Such a high standard has now been achieved in the scope of our relationships and of our brotherhood, which is matchless and peerless. When we observe a normal worker residing in Qadian meeting others who reside in the United States and in Russia, or someone who lives in an Arab country meets with others who live in Europe, or when anyone meets anyone else, then that spirit can be observed, which makes manifest that quality of brotherhood of the believers. This spirit should enhance this quality of brotherhood. If a person has pride and arrogance in his heart, then he will not meet his brothers with the spirit of brotherhood. Or if there is a wealthy person living in a certain place, then towards a poor person, whether he is acquainted with him or not, or his relationship with him is strong or weak, or whether he possesses any malice or complaints against him, until all animosity and resentment is not removed from one's heart, all sense of superiority and the distinction between rich and poor is not eliminated, and the example of brotherhood is not demonstrated, then the speeches of the Jalsa Salana will have no benefit to such participants, nor will the atmosphere of the Jalsa be of any use to such attendees. Coming to the Jalsa will be worthless and useless for them. As a result of the hard-heartedness of such persons, the environment of Jalsa Salana will be devoid of spirituality for him. So thus, if you want to take full benefit from the purposes of the Jalsa Salana, then always keep this very objective of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam in view. This is such an important objective of the Jalsa Salana, which the Promised Messiah alayhi salam has especially outlined. So thus, all of you should attend this Jalsa whilst keeping this in mind. Eliminate the differences between rich and poor and between being superior or inferior. even if you have any personal grievances, then in this atmosphere you should eradicate them in such a way as if they never even were harbored. The permanent residents of Gardian would also have to analyze their own hearts. They would have to scrutinize their own selves. Because Allah the Almighty has granted them an opportunity to live in the abode of the promised Messiah and Imam Mahdi. The atmosphere of this abode should be exactly what the promised Messiah alayhi salam desired it to be. And to this end, the promised Messiah alayhi salam strove to educate and morally train the community. We should also give special heed to the fact that Allah the Almighty has also given the residents of Gardian another opportunity in their lifetimes to attend a Jalsa Salana. Avail of this excellent opportunity to train and educate yourselves. So where on the one hand, every attendee of this Jalsa Salana will establish this relationship of love, brotherhood and affection, there, each and every single Ahmadi who lives in Gardian should analyze his own self in this manner. That is, he really striving to attain this objective? It is this very analysis that will alleviate your hearts from worldly desires. It will enable you to fully submit and incline towards the hereafter and bring realization within you to this effect. It will cultivate the fear of God within. You would not be concerned for the desires of this world. In fact, the subject matter of وَلْتَنْزُرْ نَفْسٌ مَا قَدَّمَتْ لِغَدْ would come before you. You would make an effort that for the sake of attaining the pleasure of Allah the Almighty and in order to obtain the goodness of the life to come, you would consider what you are going to set forth from this world. You need to keep an eye on zuhud and taqwa, righteousness and your devotion. Or else you will demonstrate your materialism and worldliness. And you will remove the fear of Allah from your heart and lead your lives as such. Either you have to abide by your covenant of allegiance, your bayt, or you simply are to adorn yourselves by wearing the badge of the covenant of allegiance on you and assume that you are fulfilling your bid, your pledge of allegiance. Whether you need to cultivate the qualities of the fear of God in your heart, of forbearance and abstinence, of kindness and compassion, or you are to give room in your heart to injustices, cruelty, bad morals, and the use of bad language. And demonstrate all of these through your actions. Either you need to establish examples of humbleness, humility, and modesty, or you are to strut around with your heads held high in arrogance, pride, and haughtiness. Either you are to spread the beautiful pearls of truthfulness, or you are to accept falsehood and incur the anger of God. Either you are to prepare yourselves for religious excursions and strive to fulfill the mission of the promised Messiah alayhi salam, on whom be peace. Or you are to drown in the glitz and glamour of the world and forget your purpose and objective. So thus this analysis and this critical review of our state will tell us that to what degree are we keeping in view مَا قَدَّمَتْ لِغَدْ, that what we are sending forth for tomorrow. So therefore, these 3 days of the Jalsa are for us to take stock of these things. And it is to try and channel our actions in accordance with the will of God. And these are excellent days for this purpose. When there is greater inclination towards accepting the mutual spiritual impact of each other. Through the individual and collective offering of the tahajjud, the pre-dawn prayer, a special atmosphere is created. The places where the promised Messiah, on whom be peace, performed the sajda, prostrated in prayer, makes many a hearts enabled to offer very passionate and zealous prayers. Through imperceptible ways, there is a spiritual atmosphere which forms. So therefore, through this spiritual camp, take full benefit. There should be no Ahmadi who leaves from Qadian without attaining this objective. And there should be no Ahmadi who lives in Qadian who does not avail of these 3 days as an excellent means of his reformation. It should also be kept in view, and you need to also make full effort to abide by the following, that whatever changes you bring about within yourselves, or that you have brought about, should be long-lasting. You need to make them a permanent part of your lives. This will only then be possible when every single person seated there at the Jalsa makes a firm resolve that whatever pious changes we are to bring about, we must remain established and steadfast upon them for the rest of our lives. You need to make a determined resolution that from all the speeches of the Jalsa and intellectual discussions that we hear, we will not only make it a means of increasing our religious knowledge on a short-term or temporary basis, but in fact, on a permanent and everlasting basis, we now need to make constant efforts for the rest of our lives to increase our religious knowledge. You also must make a firm resolve that we will not be amongst such persons who do not practice what they preach. Whatever knowledge you have ascertained, you now need to apply in your lives. Always keep this command of Allah the Almighty in view, that Ya أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لِمَا تَقُولُونَ مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ, that O ye who believe, why do you say what you do not do? So that's when constant attention remains upon these aspects. It is only then that the objectives of the Jalsa will be achieved. It is only then that those long-lasting and long-term objectives will be achieved, for which the promised Messiah, on whom be peace, has taken the bet, the pledge of allegiance from us for. It is only then that we can obtain permanent and long-lasting benefit from the blessings of the Jalsa Salana. And only then will we remain constantly focused upon our reformation and take constant self-analysis. It is only then that we can establish pious examples before our children. And only then can we become the means of reforming our children. It is only then that we will remain focused and attentive towards fulfilling the right of guiding our subordinates and those under our influence. It is only then can we discharge the right of tabligh, of preaching. Thus, this is a massive task that every single one of us must fulfill. However, its standard can then be reached when we come to believe in the realities. And instead of looking at our good qualities, we also keep an eye upon our shortcomings and flaws and always search out for them. And it is only when we become restless for the forgiveness of Allah the Almighty, it is only when we submit before the commands of Allah and the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we demonstrate those standards of obedience where there is no excuses, but in fact there are very large walls in front of the path of making any excuses. It is only when we set barriers in the path of making any excuse. This standard will then be achieved. When we give preference to the teachings and the expectations of the promised Messiah alayhi salam and his wishes from his Jamaat over and above all our wishes. It is only when we exhibit models of honesty, sincerity and commitment in accordance to the wishes of the promised Messiah alayhi salam. What expectations did the promised Messiah alayhi salam have of us? Always keep your word and deed right and in concordance. In the same manner that the companions, may Allah be pleased with them, demonstrated in their lifetimes, you should also follow in their footsteps and exhibit your models of truthfulness and sincerity. Always keep the example of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq, may Allah be pleased with him, in front of you. So therefore, when we ponder on these matters, we observe amazing and wondrous models. The promised Messiah, alayhi salam, mentioned the example of Hazrat Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him. When we observe the examples of truthfulness and sincerity in his lifetimes, then they have an amazing splendor about them. When the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that he had gained a revelation from Allah that he was a Nabi, a Prophet, Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq said without asking any question that he accepted him as a Prophet of God. When the Holy Prophet Muhammad, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, said that he required financial contributions for religious excursions, and that the believers should, out of their money, give contributions for these religious expeditions, then Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq brought all the possessions and belongings from his household and presented them to the Prophet. When the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that as a result of the cruelties and persecution of the disbelievers, he had now been commanded to respond and defend against them using force, and to lift the sword in response, then Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, may Allah be pleased with him, immediately brought the sword and said he was ready and present for this purpose. When the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam at the truce of Hudaybiyah changed his mind and expressed his will that they should not fight any longer and should reconcile instead, then all became perturbed. There were many senior companions at the time, and some started developing wrinkles on their head, thinking that what had happened. However, Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq said, "This is absolutely correct. We should follow the path of reconciliation." So thus, this is that example which the promised Messiah, on whom be peace, said he expected his Jamaat to keep before them. When these standards are kept before us, then the spirit of making an effort to fulfill the expectations of the promised Messiah alayhi salam will remain established. When we observe that once during a jalsa, the promised Messiah alayhi salam's expectations were not fully met, which caused him so much pain and through which he expressed so much displeasure, then it causes us restlessness. So thus, if today we want to become a part of the purpose of the advent of the promised Messiah alayhi salam, then we need to move forward by obeying everything that the promised Messiah alayhi salam has said. We need to make an effort to develop a spiritual revolution within us. And we need to do this with that strength and passion, the example of which the companions demonstrated at the Jungi Hunain, the Battle of Hunain. Without this spirit, we cannot save ourselves from useless pastimes, nor can we save ourselves from the greed of the world, nor can we reform ourselves, nor can we understand the spirit of attending the Jalsa. Neither can we understand the purpose of the advent of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, and nor can the true spirit of serving Islam be formed within us. What came to pass in the Battle of Hunain?
Islam ki tareekh mein us waqt
In the history of Islam until that time, it was the first Muslim army that outnumbered the enemy force. However, the majority of the Muslims that were part of that army did not understand or were not aware of the true spirit of the sacrifice of a true believer. When 4,000 archers of the enemy suddenly threw arrows, then some as a result of a weakness of faith, and others as a result of their horses being disturbed, started becoming scattered, and the Muslim army became dispersed. The Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was left in the battlefield with only 12 of his companions. However, the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not retreat, despite the advice and suggestion given to him that it would be wise to turn back and to regather the army. However, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "The Prophet of God never retreats from the battlefield." In any case, on this occasion, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told Hazrat Abbas, who had a loud voice, to call the Ansar, that, "O Ansar, the Messenger of God calls upon you." In one place, Hazrat Muslihamud, may Allah be pleased with him, has given a most excellent explanation of why only the Ansar were called upon at this time. There were many reasons for this. One reason was that the reason for the defeat was some of the people of Makkah who were close to them. This is why they were slightly reprimanded, that they thought that they were great in number and relied on their acquaintances due to whom the defeat had taken place. That is, those they were relying upon, their relatives, their neighbors, and their fellow citizens. This was all as a result of them. In any case, the Ansar said that when the voice of Hadrat Abbas reached their ears, that the Messenger of God calls upon you, then we were already trying to turn our horses towards the battlefield. But this voice had such a magical effect upon it that it brought about a new passion within us like an electric current going through our bodies. Those mounts that could turn around towards the battlefield reached there with their mounts into the battlefield. Those horses or mounts that were not in a position to immediately turn or could not turn despite making an effort, then those who were mounted upon those horses cut the necks of those horses and they ran hurriedly towards the battlefield. And they said, "Labbaik ya Rasulullah, labbaik," that "We are ready, O Messenger, we are ready," and they regathered. So therefore, this is that spirit of saying labbaik, that we are ready, that today we also need to bring into effect and we need to come to understand. Today also, the chosen one of Allah, who is the ardent devotee of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is calling upon us that give attention towards your reformation. When you come to the Jalsa, strive to achieve the objectives of the Jalsa Salana. Spend your days in taqwa and in the love of Allah and in the remembrance of Allah. Spend your 3 days in trying to gain nearness of Allah the Almighty and make it a means of permanently coming close to God. Cut off the necks of the rebellious horses of your nafs, of yourself. Today, the Imam of the time, in the following of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is calling us to reform our actions. So thus, it is our duty to say labbaik, that we are ready, and need to gather around him. It is our duty to gather around him in this manner. Today we are not being called for a jihad of the sword, but today we are being called upon for a jihad of the nafs, a struggle against ourselves. The success in this endeavor will be a means of raising the flag of Islam all over the world. So as I have mentioned before, there is a need to establish new standards of love and brotherhood. We need to climb the stairs of zuhud and taqwa, righteousness and devotion. We need to search for the paths of temperance and humbleness. Through our every act, we need to uphold truthfulness and honesty. For the preaching of Islam, to sacrifice our time, wealth and honor, we need to show practical demonstration. We need to immerse our tongues with the remembrance of Allah. Through the establishment of the highest standards of worship, we need to strive to attain nearness to Allah. So thus, in these 3 days, the attendees of the Jalsa and Qadiyan take full benefit. And also, wherever Jalsas are being held nowadays, amongst which, first of all, is the Jalsa Salana of the West Coast of the United States. There is also the Jalsa Salana in Mali, in Niger, in Nigeria, in Senegal, and also in Ivory Coast. So the attendees of the Jalsa Salana everywhere should make special efforts to avail of them. At this time, I would like to present some of the extracts of the writings of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam, which draws our attention to some of those things that the Messenger of God desires from us. The Promised Messiah alayhi salam states, "I have already spoken a number of times about the unity and mutual love of the Jamaat, that you should be united. This is what Allah the Almighty taught the Muslims, that you should be as one entity, otherwise you will lose your strength. The command for standing side by side with one another is for the reason that there should be unity. Like an electric current, one's goodness will penetrate into another. If there are differences and there is not unity, you will remain devoid of blessings and fortune. The Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that you should love to one another, and you should pray for each other when not in the presence of the other person. If you pray in this matter, then the angels say that the same should happen for you. What an excellent point this is. If a person's prayer is not accepted, then at least the prayers of the angel are. I advise, and I would like to say, that you should not have discord amongst you. I have brought but two matters with me. First, it is to adopt the oneness of Allah the Almighty, and secondly, demonstrate mutual love and compassion. Show the example, which should be a miracle for others. It was this very spirit that was developed in the companions, that they were divided, but Allah the Almighty created mutual love in them. Remember, to bring two things together is a miracle. Remember, until each and every single one of you does not like for his brothers what he likes for himself, he is not from my community. He is a trial, something bad and something troublesome, and will not have a good end. The Promised Messiah alayhi salam said, "Remember, to rid others of spite and malice is one of the signs of the Mahdi. And will that sign not be fulfilled? Most certainly it will. Why do you not display patience? Just as it is a medical problem that until certain illnesses are not suppressed, the patient's illness cannot be eradicated. Through my being, inshallah, a pure Jamaat will be formed. What is the cause of personal enmities and grievances? This spite and malice, arrogance and haughtiness, selfishness and passions. I will separate all such people from the community who cannot control their passions and who are unable to live in mutual love and brotherhood. Those who do act in this manner should remember that they are only here for a short period of time. Until they do not demonstrate an excellent example, I do not want to take anyone's blame for any reason. Any such person who is a part of my Jamaat but does not act according to my will is like a dry twig. What else would a gardener do except cut it off? Dry twigs that are alongside other green and flourishing branches does absorb water, but that cannot cause it to flourish or become green. In fact, it affects others. So therefore, be fearful. He will not remain with me who does not treat or remedy himself." Then the Promised Messiah alayhi salam states that Allah says in the Quran, وَجَعَلُ الَّذِينَ تَبَعُوكَ فَوْقَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا إِلَى يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ This reassuring promise was to the son of Mary born in Nazareth. However, I give you the good tidings that the one coming under the name of the Messiah, the son of Mary, was also addressed in the following words with a good tiding. Now consider those who have an association with me and desire to be part of this great prophecy and good tiding. Can they be such people who are languishing at the stage of Amara, the self that incites of evil, and perform all manner of vices and evil? No, most certainly no. Those who truly honor this promise of Allah the Almighty and do not consider my words to be mere fables and stories, then remember and listen with your heart. I say once again something addressing those who associate themselves with me. That bond is no ordinary bond. In fact, it is a great relationship. It is such a connection which is not only limited to my being, but in fact reaches to that existence who has taken me to that perfect man, brought the spirits of truthfulness and honesty to the world. I say that if these things were only limited to affecting me, I would have no concern or worry, nor would I have any care. But it does not end here. Its effect and impact reaches to the being of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to God the Almighty. Therefore, in such a situation and state, be very vigilant and careful, and listen carefully that if you desire to take part from this glad tiding, and you have the desire testifying to it, and you have real thirst to attain this great triumph, that you remain dominant over the disbelievers until the Day of Judgment, then all I will say is this, that you will not obtain victory and success until you surpass the stage of Amara, the self that incites the evil, and reach the minaret of Mutmainna. I say no more than this, that you have a link with that person who is an appointed one of Allah the Almighty. So therefore, listen to what he says deeply with your heart and become ever ready to comply with that, lest you become amongst those who, after making a pledge, and fall in the filth of rejection, earning for themselves a permanent punishment. Then the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, states that our community should always remember this advice. They should keep in view this aspect which I present. If I have any thought, it is always this, that there are so many relationships here and there in the world. Some are formed as a result of beauty, others on the basis of families or wealth, and others on the basis of power. But Allah the Almighty does not care for any of these things. Allah the Almighty has stated clearly, Inna akramakum, inna Allahi atkakum. That is, the most honorable in the sight of Allah the Almighty is he who is the most righteous. So thus only that Jamaat that is of the righteous will be sustained by Allah the Almighty, and the other will be destroyed. And this is a very delicate station. Two cannot stand here, that the righteous are there, and also the impure and mischievous in the same place. It is definite that the righteous will remain, and the wicked and evil are destroyed. Because Allah the Almighty holds the knowledge of who in His sight is righteous, thus this is a matter of great fear. Most fortunate is he who is righteous, and wretched is he who is cursed. May Allah enable each and every single one of us to understand this pain of the promised Messiah alayhi salam, and enable us to give attention towards our self-reformation. We should remember the point that all of this is not only for the attendees of the Jalsa, not only are they addressed, but in fact each and every single Ahmadi in the world is being addressed by the aforementioned statements. Here I would like to also draw attention to the fact that every single Ahmadi living in the world during these days, when in the abode of the Messiah of Muhammad, the blessings of the Jalsa are flowing everywhere. You yourselves in particular, keep focused on the remembrance of Allah and special prayers. Pray especially for the attendees of the Jalsa in Qadian, also for all the attendees of the Jalsas everywhere else in the world. But also, every Ahmadi in the world should pray that in all those places where Ahmadis are embroiled in difficulties and they are in this tribulation for the reason that they have taken the bet, the pledge of allegiance of the Messiah Muhammad, and accepted the Imam of their time, that may Allah the Almighty alleviate their worries. In particular, Pakistan, Indonesia, Syria, and also certain other countries. May Allah the Almighty in these places bring about the means of ease and alleviate them. This is a most important prayer, which is necessary to fulfill the requirements of expressing love and brotherhood. It is the requirement of love and brotherhood that we most certainly make this prayer. May Allah the Almighty enable us to do this.
Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayhi wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyi'ati a'malina. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل واللسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله